Zone 2 training might be one of the best things you can do for your long-term health. In fact, it could be your secret weapon in the battle against age-related decline. So if you aren't familiar with the benefits or want to know more about why you should probably be doing more Zone 2, stay tuned, because in this video I'll explain what Zone 2 is, why it's important, how to determine your own Zone 2 level, how much Zone 2 you need, and how to get started. Hey everyone, it's Mark, and we're back with a video all about Zone 2 training. So let's dive in. Now, to understand what Zone 2 training is and what it does, we first have to understand how our bodies use the food we eat to power our body. Now, every single cell in the body is fueled by adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. So when you walk, you're using ATP. Eating, powered by ATP. Watching this video, yep, ATP. Everything you do is powered by ATP. Now, ATP can be produced in three primary ways. The first one is as a result of oxygen metabolism that utilizes fatty acids, in other words, oxidation. Now, this is how most of the ATP you use each day is created. When you breathe, oxygen turns fatty acids into ATP. Oxidation creates a lot of ATP, and oxidation occurs within your cell's mitochondria. Now, remember that, as that's an essential point for Zone 2. The second way is through non-oxygen glucose metabolism called glycolysis. So if you're doing an intense exercise like sprinting or lifting weights, your body switches from oxidizing fatty acids to produce ATP to burning glycogen or carbs to replenish ATP stores. Now, glycolysis produces lots of ATP, but not as much as oxidation. Now, glycolysis doesn't occur in your mitochondria, but rather in the cell's cytosol, which is basically the liquid in the cell. The third way is by recycling previously stored ATP. So when ATP transfers energy to cells, it breaks off one of its phosphates and becomes adenosine diphosphate, ADP. Now, creatine comes along and helps turn that back into ATP once more to be utilized as energy. So now that we know a little bit about what ATP is, what is Zone 2? Well, it's the area where the body is using fat oxidation for fuel, in other words, creating ATP, which powers all cells, like we learned. It's a relatively easy effort. Breathing shouldn't be strained, and you can generally carry on a conversation, but may need to pause occasionally to breathe. So that generally ends up being 70 to 80% of your maximum heart rate. So why is Zone 2 important? Well, there's really six key benefits. The first one is it increases the number of mitochondria in your body. Mitochondria are the cell's powerhouses and determine to a large part the overall health of the body. More and more research is proving that there's an absolute importance of having healthy mitochondria in your body. So Zone 2 is the level at which you're stimulating your mitochondria the most to create ATP. So as you spend more and more time in Zone 2, your body will respond by creating more and more mitochondria to power that Zone 2 activity. The more mitochondria you have, the more you're able to create ATP through fat oxidation. And remember, your mitochondria can make a lot of ATP. Now, Zone 2 training not only increases the number of your mitochondria, but it improves their efficiency as well. The more you exercise in Zone 2, the better your body gets at burning fat for fuel. Now, the body's general inefficiency at using fat for fuel can contribute to many health problems like insulin resistance, diabetes, dementia, and even cancer. So basically, if you want to move better, have more energy, and live longer, you want to exercise a lot in Zone 2. The third advantage of zone two is that it boosts mood. I've experienced this personally. I found that I have a real clarity of thinking, and it increases my creativity when exercising in zone two. So I often use my long, easy runs to work through things and come up with new ideas. It's probably because I'm getting the muscles moving and the blood flowing, but not severely stressing the body, so I can still think about things. So zone two cardio or zone two training generates plenty of feel-good endorphins. You might have heard of the runner's high. I think that's part of zone two. Now, the fourth thing is it improves cardiovascular health. So besides exercising your mitochondria, zone two training also gives your heart and blood system a workout. Your heart is going to get stronger, and it's going to require fewer pumps to pump blood. It's going to become more efficient. Your body also expands its vascular system, enabling it to deliver more oxygenated blood to the different parts of your body. Now, this improvement in cardiovascular fitness will result in better performance when exercising, as well as a lower, more efficient heart rate when not exercising. The fifth main benefit is that zone two improves your performance as an endurance athlete. You're able to go progressively faster and farther while your heart rate remains relatively low. So as you improve your body's ability to use fat for fuel, you'll become more and more able to increase your pace without shifting over to carb burning. And because you're using fat, you'll be able to go faster for a longer period of time because you have a nearly unlimited supply of fat in your body. Now, the sixth major benefit is that it reduces the chance of injury and can aid recovery. Zone two training stresses the body a little, but not a lot. And because of this, it enables you to add volume to your training while reducing the chances of getting sidelined by injuries or fatigue. Even after doing a long session of zone two one day, you'll probably be ready for another the next. Zone two can also serve as a great active recovery exercise. So after a hard workout or a race, zone two effort can really help the body recover. All right, how do you determine your zone two? The most accurate is some sort of lab test or lactate measurement while exercising. It can work, but it's awful expensive. The second way is based on a percentage of max heart rate, generally 70 to 80%. That's usually zone two. So my max heart rate of 174 gives a range of about 122 to 139 for zone two. There is a way to determine your max heart rate by doing calculations. There's several different formulas, and typically they're based on your age. So the most common one people have heard of is 220 minus your age. So in my case, 220 minus my closest birthday of 52 gives me 162. I'm going to put a link in the description to a page that can give you a few different calculators you can use to come up with your max heart rate. Now, you can use the calculators to come up with your max heart rate, or you could do an actual maximum heart rate workout like I did last fall as part of a 5K race. It's pretty accurate, but man, does it hurt. So remember, all calculations are really just estimates, but should get you in that range, especially when adjusted with the TOC test, which I'll cover here in a bit. Another way of calculating the kind of the upper range of your zone two is by using a calculation that is called 70% of your heart rate reserve. So heart rate reserve is your max heart rate minus your resting heart rate, times that by 70%, and then add in your resting heart rate. So here's an example. So for me, my max heart rate is 174. My overnight typical resting heart rate is 45. 174 minus 45 is 129. 70% of that is 90. So I take that 90 and then I add my max, my resting heart rate back in of 45. So 90 plus 45 equals 135. That's the upper range of zone two for me based off of my max heart rate. Another way of getting in the area of zone two is to use the Maffetone method, which is essentially 180 minus your age. So in my case, 180 minus 58 is 122. Now that can get you close in the ballpark, but it'll get you in the range, and then you can refine it by using the talk test. Now the talk test is the point where you can speak or sing with pausing occasionally to breathe. If you can do that, you're in zone two. If you need to stop and breathe every few words, you're probably moving over to zone three. So that means you should reduce your effort. The way that I come up with my zone two is to use my max heart rate and refine that with the talk test. So for me right now, depends on the day, but my range is typically 123 to 132 for my zone two range. What's the best way to get zone two training in? Well, the reality is any activity you can do to keep consistently in zone two without going over and under, in other words, bouncing up and down.
The best ways to do zone two work is on a trainer, bike trainer. I'm here in my basement, got my road bike hooked up to a smart trainer, connected to Zwift. You can also use Peloton, or even just a bike in the gym. It's a great way to keep your power consistent. You can adjust the power very easily and make sure you stay just in the right zone. It's a great way to do it. Plus, you can ride in a cartoon. Another way you can do zone two is on a treadmill. I've got the treadmill at about 15 degrees, so a good incline, and then you just set the pace at whatever it is to get you a good consistent heart rate. Somewhere between 2 to 4 miles an hour. So treadmill can be a great way to do it too, because you can adjust the intensity by raising the incline up or down. Another good option for doing zone two training. Of course, you could do your zone two training while running. It will have to be an easy run for you, just because running is a full body activity and it tends to get the heart rate up pretty quickly. But a nice easy run, if you monitor your heart rate, is a great way to get outside, enjoy nature, and get some zone two training in.
If you haven't been running, but you would like to run as a way to get your zone two in, I would recommend starting with the treadmill, the elliptical, or the bike trainer to get to build up that base level of fitness, and then slowly move into using running as a way to get the zone two exercise in. Okay, next question is, how much zone two do we need to be doing? Now, I'm going to make a note here that this is for general health, not any sports-specific training. We're talking about zone two for general health and fitness and longevity purposes, not how much zone two you need if you want to train for a marathon or a 10K or something like that. That'll be another video. Well, first off, any amount of time that you can get in zone two is better than none. But that being said, based on research, the sweet spot seems to be 150 to 180 minutes a week, so 2.5 to 3 hours a week, with at least 30-minute sessions. Ideally, they should be 45-plus-minute sessions. More than that seems to be fine, but many people are limited by time. So overall, think of getting 80 to 90% of your cardio training in zone two, the rest in zone five, kind of high intensity intervals. Okay, you should now have enough information to get started putting more and more zone two into your exercise or workout routine. The benefits of zone two training are no joke, literally, and they can help you live longer, live better, and with less disease. It really is a sort of secret weapon in the battle against age-related decline. So I'd be interested to know, in the comments, leave a comment if you are doing any conscious, consistent zone two training as part of your exercise routine. I'd love to hear from you and get your experiences. Now, if you're not already a subscriber, be sure to subscribe to the channel. And if you're not already part of the community, it'd be a great way to become part of the community and also give that thumbs up a little nudge to help get the word out to everybody else about what we're doing here at Life Maximus. Now, be sure to check out the description below for links to more great Zone 2 content. I've got a couple of great podcasts and a link to that max heart rate calculator. And if you want to learn more about how Zone 2 can help you compete in the centenarian decathlon, check out this video up here. That's it for now. Thanks for watching. Take care, and we will see you in the next one. Until then, be well.